The Weston A. Price Foundation presents a number of problems for the serious researcher and someone searching truly helpful dietary advice. I hope to sort a little of this out in this video series. My name is Liam Sheff. I'm author of Official Stories. This is American Heretic. I'll be taking apart some of the Weston Price and paleo ideas, I hope fairly, without being totally dismissive. If the Weston A. Price Foundation were a baseball player, they'd be doing very well. They're batting about 300. That's 3 out of 10, but for a diet program, it's pretty bad. Weston A. Price, to begin with, was a dentist from Cleveland. He traveled the world in the 1930s. He had many patients who he saw who had cavities and poor dental health. In the early 1900s, the consumption of sugar had reached over 90 pounds of sugar per year, something like 17 pounds of sugar per year in 1800 and about 4 pounds of sugar per year in 1700, and before that, it was negligible to nothing, dwindling down to nothing that you couldn't get out of some local fruit and a little bit of hard-to-get honey through the whole entirety of the human species. Sugar is new, and sugar is a problem. Sugar feeds every problem that we have, I think, from, well, teeth, bad teeth, to candida, to probably heart disease, and I'm sure cancer. The research on sugar really wasn't being done in a serious way in the 1930s. Weston, I'm going to call him Weston instead of Dr. Price. People who are always looking for a guru always try to make their gurus seem more important. So Ron Paul became Dr. Paul when he was running for president instead of just Ron. He wasn't delivering any babies on the campaign trail. I think Bill Clinton was the last candidate touching a lot of vaginas when he was running for office. Okay, sorry. But Weston A. Price wasn't. He's a dentist, and Ron Paul wasn't, so we just call him Ron. We'll call Weston Weston. He was a dentist. He was a bright guy. He was a kind guy. He was not a racist, which was a little bit different for his time, a very eugenic era. He didn't believe that people were sick because they miscegenated and had sex with the wrong people. So in many ways, he's a very laudable guy. He made some interesting observations about people having good teeth if they had enough fat-soluble vitamins and minerals and phosphorus. That said, he got a number of things wrong, which are truly worth talking about. Some of the things that he got wrong. After Weston left the world, or the business, and went away, it was generally realized that it was sugar, white sugar, that caused cavities by sticking to teeth and feeding bacteria that puke acid onto your teeth. Build little structures, matrices, that they hang out in the plaque, and inhabiting and wearing away your bone material, your enamel, your dentin, and so on. He knew that, but they didn't have names for it. He knew there were acids in the mouth. He knew sugar was a problem, but he seemed to think it was a problem by the internal mechanism rather than the external mechanism. Now, I'm all for strengthening the internal mechanism of the body, the internal organs, the blood, etc. Very, very, very important. But when we're talking about teeth, past development stage, they are being attacked from the outside. That is where the problems happen. So we're going to have to look at the superfice, the outside, to see where the attack is coming from. He thought, and he did make some interesting observations here, and I want to be fair, he thought that people had cavities in these groups that he looked at because, well, they weren't eating their native foods. Not because they had a ton of sugar, white flour, and tinned milk in their diet, but because they didn't have certain fat-soluble vitamins that were found in their native foods. Let's talk about the people that he looked at. He went around the world and looked at outliers, people who hadn't become agriculturalists, who hadn't, I wouldn't want to say crested that civilization point, but they lived in unfarmable land. So if you looked at the South Island, South Pacific Islands, they had to pick a lot of mussels and grab fish, and sometimes grab a wild pig here and there. It's very dangerous work. Probably coconuts and lots of fats in that way, and lots of seaweed and yams. I'm sure that they can dig up some yams and other kinds of roots that you find in the islands. When you go to the Greenland, when you go up north, it's very cold, nothing grows. So people were left eating seal and whale and porpoise and any kind of fish they could get their hands on, and the leftover material in reindeer and caribou stomach. No kidding. Just to have some plant material. Seal spleen, just to get some vitamin C. When you look at the Maasai, you look at people who have some plants, not that many. It's not easy land to farm. You can't really farm it. So you herd cattle, you move them about, you can't afford to kill them because that's your, what, blood and milk. So they ate blood and milk, and they took the blood and they pounded it into a gooey mush. Try selling that at your next Paleo or Weston A. Price get-together. And I know Paleo and Weston A. Price are mortal enemies. I read the blogs, I know. No, they're not, Liam. Well, depends on who you read. So the Maasai had that diet, all very high protein, all very high fat, very high animal fat, low plant food, except some of the people he looked at had relatively high plant food. The people who had the most animal food had the fewest cavities. He was a dentist. That's what he was concerned with. When you are a hammer, everything looks like a, well, a tooth, I guess. He didn't look at childhood mortality. He didn't look at patricide, eldercide. He didn't look at levels of heart disease, stroke, coronary problems. He didn't, of course, look at atherosclerosis, plaques in the heart. He didn't look at anything outside of teeth. And he was enthused about bodily strength. Oh, they could lift 100 pounds. Yeah, so can anybody in America who works out. He wasn't really concerned about health then. He was concerned about teeth. And he made some interesting observations vis-a-vis teeth that I will talk about in this and upcoming episodes. But for now, let's talk about, well, people in the South Seas, when they didn't have enough food because they couldn't farm, it was admitted that they gave into cannibalism. This is a problem. The Inuit, let's go way north, terrible, terrible health, very weak bones for having the most calcium of everybody on Earth, bad, very high levels of osteoporosis for having the most calcium of anybody on Earth. Why? Most calcium because they eat fish bones. Why osteoporosis? Because they eat so much protein and saturated fat, which both impede the absorption of calcium, not just that, but suck calcium out of your blood and bones to balance the acids produced by eating these things, especially high levels of protein in the blood. In other words, the more animal foods you eat, the more acid you have in your blood, the more of a problem it is to digest, the more calcium and minerals you'll suck out of your bones to balance it, then you'll deposit that in your kidneys, and you'll have stones. You may develop arterial plaques, heart plaques, atherosclerosis, you may get these plaques in your heart. Well, the Maasai have plaques in their heart when they die. They don't have a high level of heart disease. Of course, they tend to die young, as do the Inuit and the Eskimos. They tend to die young. And their average death rate, which is factored by their very high childhood mortality, but they also start dying somewhere in their 40s in large numbers. And nobody really is going to make it past, well, somewhere in their 50s. Might be lucky and make it to 60-something. No, that's, look, we don't know how long anybody gets. I'm not telling anybody that there's a specific number that they have to reach to be any kind of good person. But if you look at an average, you can say that the diet of we here today in America, for being worse than any diet that we've ever had in America, is simply better than the diet of the Inuit or the Maasai, because we still don't die on average in our 40s. And if you remove childhood mortality, people still die in their 70s here. Why might that be? Who did I leave out? Well, like I said, the Maasai do have arterial plaques, but they eat about half of the calories, half to two-thirds of the calories that any American does. They walk about 12 to 15 miles a day. Their arteries increase in size to allow increased blood flow. This happens through a lifetime of exercise. They still drop dead earlier, and they still have plaques in their heart, so they're not immune from heart disease. Eskimos were for a long time thought to be immune from heart disease because the two Danish researchers who told us this were assholes. They said that the Inuit don't have heart disease, but they never looked at an Inuit heart. They never did any research on a heart. They weren't cardiologists. I think they were nutritionists, and they decided what people ate must stop them from getting heart disease. They decided they didn't have heart disease, not because they talked to anybody or interviewed anybody. They went to some outlying areas and sort of the local government doctor who had to write down why people might have died after it was reported to them from, you know, some sort of hut 200 miles away that they died because of this. Well, we don't know why they died. They died. And that's how they got the research that said not only is fish oil really good for you because it prevents heart disease, but Eskimos don't have heart disease. Subsequent reports, and if that was confusing, let me say it this way. The original research that said Inuits don't get heart disease was intensely flawed and not based on actually looking at Inuits. It looked at their diets and made an assumption that they didn't die of heart disease, but they do. In fact, they die young. In fact, they have terrible abdominal issues, high levels of appendicitis. Even the mummies of ancient people, fossilized remains of ancient hunters and gatherers and high meat eaters, all have plaques in their hearts, including Inuit. People in, I think, Greenland have terrible, terrible diseases, even though they were eating the perfect paleo diet. So the idea that these people were the models of health around the world leaves something to be desired. It isn't to say that they didn't have good teeth. They did have good teeth. Bad bones, good teeth. The Maasai seem to have reasonably good bones, and they're very tall, which might tell you something about drinking a lot of milk. Milk seems to be a growth factor. And I read in a couple places that Maasai women are pushed away from milk when they're pregnant and pushed into grains and vegetables. Why? Because they don't want the babies to be so big that they can't give birth to them, so that they die when they give birth. You might think about the recommendations of the Weston A. Price Foundation to drink as much milk as possible, liters a day. I had a friend who a liter a day of raw milk for a while, not paying attention to the fact that these contain mammalian hormones. Now, the Weston A. Price Foundation wants you to pay attention to plant hormones, which actually block the uptake of mammalian hormones, therefore reducing cancer in populations that eat a lot of foods with plant, not mammalian hormones. But that's for a future episode. Weston A. Price got a lot wrong, clearly. He got a few things right. Teeth seem to do well in the presence of phosphorus, reasonable amounts of calcium, vitamin A, vitamin D, probably vitamin K, which I think he called a mystery factor, which labeled the Weston A. Price Foundation called an X factor. I think they've decided it's vitamin K in a variety of forms. So the body definitely needs a number of these vitamins. Okay, so have a little. A little, right? By the way, the grains and beans that the paleo people tell you not to eat will save you from a heart attack and from cancer. That's what phytic acid and lectins do. They're not anti-nutrients, they're nutraceuticals. I'll do an entire episode on that, but if you really wonder why people who eat a lot of plants in the Mediterranean and the Americas who were more vegetable plant leaning, not vegans, but more vegetable and plant leaning, was because they ate a lot of foods that had antioxidants in them. You can call an antioxidant an anti-nutrient if you want, because it blocks the absorption of something that might be toxic at high doses, but I won't. Also, if you want to get rid of these terrible phytates and lectins, you can do things like cook your food. I know, hard to do. Or eat a variety of foods. Or eat some fruits and vegetables that have vitamin C in them, thereby reducing your problem with these deadly phytates. I'll do a whole thing on that soon. Weston A. Price did find that if you fed people who had bad cavities a diet rich in a very, well, let's be clear, a very small amount of grass-fed butter from cows or sheep, or I suppose goats. I don't know anybody who makes goat butter, but goat butter butt. I said it. I can't take it back now. Very small amounts of vitamin-rich butter mixed with a little bit of non-fermented, doesn't mention the word fermented in his book that I can find in terms of cod liver. If you find it, I'll apologize, but he actually talks about the toxicity of cod liver oil at anything above small doses. Go figure. Wow. Weston A. Price in his book talking about the toxicity of cod liver oil at anything above small doses, and I mean a teaspoon and a half a day, people. Read Weston A. Price's book. Skip the travelogue. It's not worth it. It's anachronistic writing. It takes too long to get to the point, and there's too much possibly condescending talk about the moral fiber of people relating to the nutrient-rich diets. Okay, whatever. People are people. If you want to get to the interesting part, get to the part where he's actually treating patients and giving them a teaspoon and a half, 3 half teaspoons per day. A little bit of mixed cod liver oil and grass-fed butter. Does that sound like the Weston A. Price diet to you? It doesn't to me. He loves whole wheat. Boy, does he love whole wheat. He can't get enough whole wheat. Was the whole wheat that different in 1930? Maybe a bit. Can you still get whole wheat that's organic? And yes, you can. You could also eat any number of variety of grains that have the phytates and lectins that will... They didn't seem to impede cancers and heart diseases, break up kidneys, stop you from getting the kidney stones that you'll get from eating so much animal food. But of course, if you give in to the idea that lectins go away when you cook and the ones that you have you actually need to prevent disease, and the phytates go away when you cook and the ones that you still have you can minimize by eating vitamin C in tiny doses, you have to bury these two diets along with their founders. Well, may Mr. Atkins rest in peace. I'm not trying to beat up on anybody. We're all going to die sometime. I'm not trying to be better than anybody. We all are going to face challenges. Life is hard. There is no perfect diet. The vegan diet is far from perfect, and I will do a series on that too. Next time, paleo. I will have a look at that, and I will continue with the analysis of the Weston A. Price diet. My name is Liam Sheff. My book is Official Stories. This is American Heretic. If you enjoy this message of independent diet journalism, please put a couple dollars into the PayPal. Thank you very much.